Hey folks, it's Jared Manninen from the website TahoeTrailGuide.com. Today I'm going to talk about diagonal striding off track, off trail, and in the backcountry. This topic of discussion is kind of born out of the question that I'm asked from time to time regarding diagonal striding in deep snow. Although that's a very specific topic, I think it's actually part of a broader context of, is it possible to diagonal stride in the backcountry when there's no tracks, off trail, that sort of thing. So I want to talk about just this idea of diagonal striding in the backcountry. Keep in mind that I'm an actual certified through PSIA cross-country ski instructor. I work at a big cross-country ski resort where we have on payroll every season upwards of 40 other instructors. So we have a huge ski school, and in fact it's the largest cross-country ski school in the United States. And of those 40 or so instructors, we just have this huge wealth of knowledge that I get to experience and learn from. So 50% of my season is on groomed terrain. I teach on it, I ski on it while I'm up at work, and then when I come home to the south shore of Lake Tahoe, I do the other half of my skiing in the backcountry, off track and off trail. Now, just because I'm steeped in this formal education environment at a groomed cross-country ski area doesn't mean that when I'm in the backcountry, I want to be out there racing and just, you know, blazing across miles and miles of open terrain. At the same time, I don't want to just be walking around on my skis, because if I wanted to do that, I would just get snowshoes. We're on skis, on cross-country skis, so let's ski. It's obviously not always going to be a one-for-one transferable skill necessarily from groomed terrain that's ideal to one that's filled with, you know, like today, soft snow mixed with crunchy icy snow mixed with sticky snow. It's just different when you're in the backcountry trying to diagonal stride, but you can still diagonal stride. And essentially it enhances your experience. It gives you more freedom of movement. It enables you to travel further, faster, more efficiently, more effectively, and safely. So with that thought in mind of diagonal striding the backcountry, I just want to kind of go over my approach to it. The first rule of thumb that I use to evaluate what type of gear that I'm going to use is how deep the snow is or what the state of the snowpack is. If it's firm snow, I'm going to use a skinnier ski. And if it's deeper snow, I'm going to use a wider ski. It's not super complex to understand that, I hope. The reason I use a skinny ski, and I use the Fisher Spider 62, so it's 62 millimeters wide at the tip of the ski or the shovel area, the front of the ski. And that's a pretty narrow ski for off-track cross-country skiing. But the reason I use it on firm surface snow is because I don't need much float. The snow is not collapsing underfoot. It's pretty much what you see is what you get. It's a nice, even, uniform surface for the most part. And I find these conditions usually in spring conditions, spring-like conditions, where you have a perpetual freezing and thawing cycle, and it's just transforming that snow into effectively cement, but it softens up at some point too. Also in firm snow, it's more challenging to manipulate a wide cross-country ski, because inherently most cross-country ski boots are softer. It takes a lot more effort to put those wide skis on edge in firm surfaces. Therefore, I use that skinnier ski because it just takes less effort. There's less ski to twist side to side so that you can get more edge control on harder surfaced snow. On the other end of the spectrum, I use a wide ski. I have a set of Fisher S-bound 112 millimeter wide skis, and that's the width, again, at the tip of the ski or at the shovel. I use those in really deep snow because they do enable me to float more. I don't have to feel like I'm cutting through the snow every time I take a step, which can be super exhausting, and you're not going to get anywhere in those conditions on skinny skis. So a wider ski is very helpful in deep snow conditions. So basic rule of thumb, firm snow, skinny skis, deep snow, wide skis. From zero or from firm snowpack up to 8 to 10 inches, I also have a couple other width skis in the in between that 62 millimeter and 112 millimeter. So I have the Excursion 88s made by Fisher and then the S-Bound 98s. Depending on, again, what the quality of the snowpack is and how deep that snow is, I'll take the 88 millimeters for anything between 3 to 6 inches of snow, and then the 98 millimeter wide S-Bounds, I'll take, I don't know, 4 to 8 inches of snow, 5 to 8 inches of snow. It's really personal preference, what skis are waxed. Yeah, it's not a super exact science by any means. And if you only have one set of skis, that's the skis that you're going to be running. But ideally, you would have at least a skinny and a wide set so that you can, you know, bridge the gap between firm conditions and really deep snow conditions. Some of the other conditions, what I would consider best case scenario conditions, are a couple of inches of snow on a firm, stable snowpack with a medium width ski. That for me is ideal cross-country ski diagonal stride conditions for the backcountry, because what that little bit of snow, whether it's, you know, a half inch to 3 inches of snow does, is it helps keep your skis from skidding around. It takes more work to push through the snow, but you don't have to worry about them sliding to the sides nearly as much, because it just, it kind of packs around the skis and lets them track straighter. You still got to work, but it's much easier when you got just a little bit of fresh snow on top of firm snow. Another ideal condition is when it's firm, like in the spring, but it softens up by mid to late morning due to the rising temperature and the sun hitting it. And then you have that little layer of slush on top, which acts in a similar fashion. It allows for really good grip, but it also allows you to track your skis straight because, again, you're not on ice. That brings me to my least favorite conditions, which are icy, crusty, hard snow, which is more like combat or survival skiing and very challenging to track your skis straight because all cross-country skis on ice want to do all kinds of crazy stuff, and it's really a lesson in patience when dealing with that. And a lot of times, in fact, on that hard, firm, icy stuff, I just double pull the entire way because I don't want to even try to keep some sort of rhythm. It takes more effort to keep that rhythm diagonal striding on icy conditions. Same goes for pockmarked and wind scoured snow that's just got ridges and bumps and grooves and divots. You know, it's not unlike being on a well-used forest service trail that's got 1,000 different users making 1,000 different marks into the trail. It's just really challenging, really frustrating, but it kind of falls in line with that icy, crusty snow condition. It's my least favorite. In really deep snow, I wouldn't say it's my least favorite, but it's some of the most challenging snow to try to diagonal stride in. As I mentioned previously, 8 to 10 inches is about the max that I can really do any kind of diagonal striding. And a lot of times that's with a low angle downhill I can glide. And again, that's assuming that there's a firm base underneath that fresh snow. It's not completely bottomless, 3 feet of fresh snow. And a lot of times in that deep snow, no, you're not going to be able to diagonal stride. That's the bottom line. Like, it's just going to take too much work. It's going to be too much effort, and you are going to be slogging through it. You're going to be walking through it. But there's times too that you can mix in bounding or loping through the snow. So you can kind of go into a really rhythmic jogging motion through that snow. You're not going to get the glide phase necessarily like you would on, you know, just regularly diagonal striding. But you will move faster. It is fun for at least a little while, as long as your stamina will allow for it. But that's about the most that I can get when trying to cross-country ski through stuff that's at least a foot, you know, over 10 inches, foot to 2 feet. It's just really challenging regardless of width of ski. You have to push so much snow. It's a struggle. So it's not my favorite diagonal stride experience, but it's actually usually really fun, because when you're out there with that fresh snow, chances are it's going to be a snowstorm or a bluebird day the next day following that snowstorm. So the views in and of themselves are worth going out and seeing, even though it's going to be a pretty, you know, hardy excursion for you. Usually in those cases, I'll dial back my expectations and just plan to be out for a much shorter amount of time so I don't completely exhaust myself. And also knowing that I'm not going to get far, very far, no matter what I do. A couple of other snow conditions that are challenging for backcountry cross-country skiing would be dust on crust. So you have a firm, crunchy, icy type base, but then you have just a layer of powdery, dry stuff that happened to fall overnight. For example, that can be pretty challenging, but again, in a firm base scenario, I'm going to use a skinnier ski, and that little bit of powdery snow that's on top can actually make gripping sometimes doable. So if it's doable, I'll diagonal stride. If not, I'm going to be double poling or going home for the day. You know, it's again kind of not the best, not the worst case scenario, but kind of on the lower end of the enjoyment scale there. Another kind of less than ideal snow situation for backcountry cross-country skiing is breakable crust. That's usually with a moderately firm surface, not like super icy hard surface, but it's got a surface that you can break off and, you know, have like the size of a, you know, big pizza wedge or something like that. So it's got this crusty top, but then underneath is sugary. So it breaks through every time you put a lot of pressure. And in those cases, when I'm diagonal striding on the flats, I have to compress the ski a lot softer than if I was on a hard packed surface. Otherwise, you're constantly plunging into the snow with every step you take. What I find to be the most challenging about that breakable crust scenario, however, is going downhill because of the unpredictable nature of the crust giving way when you're trying to make some sort of a turn or slow down. That's kind of very challenging, but fortunately, a lot of times underneath that little crusty layer, again, is that softer, sugary snow. So if you go down, it's not completely painful, for example. Still challenging to do. But again, I will definitely tone down how aggressive I am with compressing the ski, flattening the ski for push-off when I'm diagonal striding across breakable crust. And that scenario for snow, I'll use a wider ski. Just again, to keep some sort of buoyancy or some sort of float over the snow so I'm not, again, constantly cutting through with skinny skis. Snow that's really wet and sticky and heavy that comes in kind of like late season snow, for example, when the air temperature is right at 32. So it might be 30 or 31 up above and it's snow, but then by the time it gets to the ground, it's just really great for making snowballs and snowmen. It's fun snow because it sticks to everything, but it also sticks to your skis if you haven't waxed them properly. Depending on snow depth, I'll just use that basic rule of thumb of, you know, less snow means a skinnier ski and more snow means a wider ski, but you definitely want to wax for a warmer snow condition. A lot of times in the backcountry, I will carry with me a tin of like Swix F4 paste, the universal wax that I can put on there. The reason I use a tin rather than a deodorant stick that's liquid is because if I do go down, I don't want to risk exploding that stick of liquid wax and having it mess up everything in my backpack or hip belt or whatever. So I'll bring a tin. I'll still put it in a plastic baggie, again, just in case it opens somehow. But I'll use that in worst case scenario, sticky snow conditions in the backcountry. But yeah, as long as, you know, hey, I have wide enough skis and the wax is right, diagonal striding actually is pretty enjoyable in that kind of sticky snow. But you have to, or at least I have to, again, kind of moderate my tempo. I'm not trying to go super fast because it comes to a screeching halt when that snow starts to, you know, the suction is created from the snow, the stickiness to the snow. So I moderate my tempo a little bit. So I'm really kind of mellow when I'm going through that really wet and sticky snow. Another kind of interesting and unique snow experiences like what I'm experiencing today, where we have kind of dry and cold snow where I'm standing here in the shade, but underneath all these trees, and I'm sure you can hear behind you, all the snow is falling out because it's melting. And what it does then around the tree well is create all this crusty layer of ice right there. So navigationally, I tend to avoid going directly beneath trees or anywhere near them if at all possible, and try to capitalize on some of that nicer, fluffier snow. And even at the same time, the sun is baking the stuff that's fully exposed, so now I'm dealing with sticky snow. So today's skiing experience is a whole range of different snow conditions, with dry powdery stuff in the shade, icy crunchy stuff under trees, and then in the sun it's baked in sticky snow. The bottom line with trying to diagonal stride in the backcountry is that the rhythm is not going to be nearly as smooth and effortless as when you're in groomed terrain or groomed cross-country ski areas. It's just the nature of the beast, so you will find that you're going to be walking from time to time, and that's fine. It doesn't matter. You're outside, you're having a good time, but when you can, when those conditions present themselves, it's like, oh yeah, here we're on the conveyor belt, let's use it. You know, kind of thing. That's how I approach it. I'm not always trying to just diagonal stride every step of the way when I'm in the backcountry. I just know that that's not a reality. It's not going to be that easy to accomplish because the variability of the snow conditions is so great that, you know, it's a constant modification to your body movement and the technique that you're using. Made even more challenging if you don't have appropriate skis, or they're not waxed for the condition, for example. So it's still a super awesome thing to be able to diagonal stride in the backcountry. I totally recommend learn ideal technique, invest more in technique than gear, in spite of me also trying to push having multiple sets of skis to accommodate different snow conditions. I know that's going to be a costly endeavor, this whole thing, but you know, if you're in it for the long haul, cross-country ski gear is relatively inexpensive compared to a lot of other sports, so don't feel like you're wasting your money on it. Make sure you get out and use it, obviously, so that you do get your money's worth. But also, and even more so, invest in technique. Take lessons, practice, dial back expectations in certain environments, go lay your own tracks, and just work on diagonal striding. Again, so long as you have the skills necessary to run the gear, you're going to have a much more enjoyable time. You're going to be more efficient. You're going to have better effectiveness for moving forward. You'll be able to explore more terrain. You're going to end up with more confidence, which can lead to a false sense of security. So obviously you have to keep your ego in check and make sure you don't bite off more than you can chew. But if you have the skills, it makes the time outside so much more immersive, enjoyable. You can stop thinking about struggling and more about enjoying the scenery around you. Anyway, I don't mean this to turn into some sort of sales pitch for taking lessons, but like with anything, the more you become proficient at doing this thing, this craft, this art, this sport, the more enjoyment you can reap from that experience. So take lessons and have the right gear. Okay, folks, that's all I got today. If you have any questions or feedback or want to continue this conversation, post it in the comment section below. Please subscribe to my YouTube channel, like this video, and then check out TahoeTrailGuide.com, where I have a lot more detailed information about cross-country skiing. If you feel compelled to contribute in a financial way to the health and longevity of Tahoe Trail Guide and this YouTube channel, I have a Patreon account as well as a PayPal and Venmo option for sending gratuities my way. I just want to say how much I appreciate all of your support. You guys have been amazing. Yeah, very exciting. Appreciate all the conversations that we've been able to have online. So keep it all coming. Anyway, I got to go home. Take care, everyone. GoPro stop capture.